This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
Thank you all for coming this week, and thank you for coming to all of the different lecture sessions. It's been a really great series of discussions, and we're capping it off with female sexual health. Dr. Rowan is on faculty with OBGYN, and she has a special interest in sexual health, so it's really exciting to have her here for this talk.
Well, welcome. Thank you for coming. I know that this is a kind of unique Wednesday in the midst of the week. There weren't any sessions last night or tomorrow night, so we know that it can sometimes take some extra effort. So as Dr. Lager said, my name is Tammy Rowan. I'm an assistant professor on faculty in the OBGYN department in the Division of Gynecology. Tonight, I want to talk about aging and sexuality, and part of this discussion is really going to be talking about how it's more than just menopause. We usually just think about menopause and we think about hormones, and that's kind of the end of it when we talk about sex. But I want to start getting us to think about bigger issues when it comes to female sexual health as we age. So we're going to talk a little bit about some definitions in epidemiology. I'm going to give you some good case examples, and these are cases from my clinical practice. Obviously, you know, some information has been changed a little bit. There's never any identifiers, but I want to use this to kind of help us to stimulate some discussion and thoughts about treatments, about physiology, and then we're going to talk about some classifications. So this is when I get into giving us the little mini med school, the lectures that I give to the medical students, to the residents, to the faculty about how we actually think on a clinical level when we're defining categories of female sexual dysfunction. And we're going to talk about some treatment options as well, that will be at the end, in terms of from the medical side. So when we talk about sexual health, there's a lot of definitions that people use. I like the definition from the World Health Organization technical consultation from 2002. So this is definitely an older definition, but I think that it really does encompass what I want us to think about when we discuss sex. So sexual health is a state of physical, emotional, mental, and social well-being related to sexuality. It's not just talking about the absence of a disease or dysfunction or infirmity. We discuss this a lot when we think about other quality of life indicators. It's not just about disease and disability. It's really about having safe and pleasurable experiences. And I really appreciated that the WHO back then even said that this was an important and integral aspect to human development and that it should be considered a human right. So a lot of times, there's a kind of stereotype that women don't care about sex, that women have sex for multiple reasons that we'll get into, but I think that we should talk about the evidence. Where does that come from? The best study that really looked at whether or not women care about sex was done back in the early to mid-2000s, and it looked at over almost 14,000 women from almost 30 countries. And what they found was that about two-thirds of women were sexually active in the last year, about a third in the last week. There was an inverse age relationship. So as women age, you are going to see the frequency of sexual activity go down. And this is very similar to what we see in U.S. data. And this relates to when we talk about aging and sex. And I'll talk about, you know, what we know about the U.S. and then many of the reasons why there is an inverse relationship. But I think what's important is that many of these women, a third, said that sex was very or extremely important to life. And, you know, just having a third of women say that, three quarters felt that satisfactory sex was essential to maintain a relationship. But only 22% reported discussing sex with a physician. So there's clearly a disconnect here. So if women aren't asking about it, are physicians actually talking to their patients about it? And so there's not that many studies out there, but one that we know of about primary care physicians found that only about a quarter of primary care physicians take a sexual history. And again, these are older studies. There is nothing recent. I review a lot of this evidence all the time, and there's very few studies looking at really how often people are asking. The one that got a lot of press was the Sobecki article. So this was published in the Journal of Sexual Medicine in 2012, and they surveyed about 1,100 gynecologists, and they found that a good number did ask about sexual activity, but even less asked about sexual function, and far less of them actually asked about sexual orientation as well as satisfaction when they were asking about sexual activity or sexual function. Oftentimes when you go to your doctor's office, they say, are you sexually active? Yes or no. That's basically it. Sometimes they'll say, do you have problems with sex? Yes or no. That's basically it. And it's on a piece of paper. People actually aren't even asking this face to face. And the reason that this is important, obviously, in my practice, if I actually just ask somebody face-to-face, do you have issues with sex? If they say, I'm not sexually active, I don't end it there. I oftentimes say, would you like to be? Is there a reason that you're not? So we can actually open a door, because just saying no is not really the answer that I'm looking for unless someone's perfectly happy to not be sexually active, in which case that's totally fine. The other, you know, when we talk about who's getting asked about, being asked about sexual health, it is important to know that there's a lot of other providers out there that people go to see. It's not just gynecologists. I'm a gynecologist, so I kind of focus on my specialty a lot. But in major studies that were done looking at who women are asking, the highest number were definitely going to their gynecologists, but they're also going to their psychiatrists. They're also going to their urologists. They're going to their internists. And then those that have cancer are certainly going to be talking to their oncologists about it, or they might be talking to their surgeons about it if they're getting surgery that affects their sexual health. So there's a lot of specialties that take care of women with sexual health concerns. And part of what I feel really strongly about is making sure that they're all aware of what their treatments do in terms of sexual health. So I think the bottom line is that sexual activity is an integral part of overall health, that women would like to discuss sex, and that many providers aren't asking about it. And I just would say that we're not doing it because we're not quite sure how to ask, we're not sure what to ask, and then the main issue is that we're unfamiliar with treatment options. And there actually were some studies, I didn't put them up here, showing that, you know, patients aren't asking about sex because they're worried that they're going to embarrass their provider, and they're also worried that there's not going to be any treatments for them, so what's the point of asking? You're opening up a can of worms that can't actually be closed. And I think that that comes from both the provider and the patient. So let's talk about a case. So this is a 51-year-old woman comes into my office to discuss a change in her level of desire. She said that she used to have very satisfying sex. She and her husband had been together for 25 years, and she was so excited because her kids finally went off to college, but now she feels like her desire should be higher to rekindle their sexual relationship. She was seen by another doctor who told her this was normal. She's 51, she's been married for 25 years, so she should just get used to this. This is, you know, about almost every patient that I see that comes into me that's older complaining of sexual function. They have asked someone else, and this is what they're told. So let's talk about this. There's a lot of questions that this brings up. So really, is this just a normal part of aging? Is that true? Should we just accept that? Are there any treatments that could possibly help this woman? And is it even reasonable to see a doctor over something that usually is considered a social problem? So a lot of people want to take sex out of the medical office and just talk to a therapist about it. So I think these are all reasonable questions, and I'm just going to address them here. So this is what we know about the research on aging and sex. So we know that sexual interest does slowly diminish with advancing age. So there are very well done studies that look at women at various ages. And I think that we should say that interest definitely does decrease. We know that there's a greater variability in all sexual parameters with higher age. So the older women get, their desire changes, the frequency of sex changes, the type of sex they're having changes. And that what has been looked at is that, you know, when we look at midlife and older women, that sexuality is really dependent on things like general well-being, physical and mental health, quality of relationship, and life situations. So there certainly is, it's not just about sex and desire, it's a huge broader context, because sex isn't just a physical condition. It actually involves a lot of different aspects. I know that I'm talking to people who know all of this, but I think it's really important to really address that because we're going to circle back to that a lot throughout this talk. So we also know that the strength of sexual interest depends on past sexual experience and the quality and meaning that sexuality had in younger years. So obviously, the more sexual experiences you have, over time that builds, and it's going to change how you relate to sex, how you relate to your partner as you get older. So when people stop having sex, this can be many things. They may not want to have sex anymore, but it also could be an expression of emotional problems. There could be problems in communication. There can be problems in the relationship. There can be feelings of guilt. There can also be pain. There can also just be a natural decrease in desire. And again, I think the key thing is that I always want to say that people who aren't sexually active, this is not pathologic. It's not that everybody should be having sex. I think there's a lot of pressure socially for people to be in Sex in the City and having great, meaningful sex all the time. And I don't think that's real. And I don't think it's realistic. And I think that my goal is for people to kind of really think about what is important to them, what do they want, and how can we get them there. So let's talk a little bit about endocrinology. So I want to just talk about testosterone and estrogen. So we'll start with just testosterone. Most people have heard of these hormones. So testosterone is mainly made by the ovaries, and they make most of the hormones. And really what testosterone does is it helps maintain the neurons kind of throughout the body, but especially in the vagina and the vulva. It definitely is related to sexual appetite. So people's level of desire is definitely related to how much testosterone is in their body. And then testosterone, there are testosterone receptors in the vestibule, the periurethra, and the clitoris. And so I didn't want to make this an anatomy lesson, but you will hear me talk about the vestibule a lot. And the vestibule is the area in front of the, when you look at kind of a woman's reproductive organs, the space between her vagina and her perineum. That encompasses the labia, that is going to be her vulva, and then the vestibule is the opening around where her vagina is. And the vagina is where, obviously, the baby comes out, where there is a connection from the outside, the vestibule vulva, to the uterus. So that's the vagina. And the vagina and the vestibule are different. They derive actually from very different, from different tissue, and they can respond a little bit differently to different kinds of hormones. The periurethra is the tissue which is near the urethra, which is where you urinate from. And then the clitoris, most people are familiar with, is at the very top of the vulva, and that's where you're going to see a hugely, highly concentrated bunch of neurons that is where most women derive most of their sexual pleasure from, is going to be in the clitoris. So estrogen is very important for the vagina as well. It's associated with lubrication. It's also associated with clitoral volume, and it also is associated with sexual desire, initiation, and masturbation. So a lot of times people focus on just testosterone, but estrogen, actually, and we'll talk about this a little bit, is a huge player. And part of the reason that we know that estrogen is a huge player is because testosterone in the body gets turned into estrogen. And so there's actually a direct link between testosterone and estrogen. They're very strongly related. So when we're treating people, we need to remember that there's a very strong link between these two. So what happens to women as they age? So this is testosterone level. So you see this is if you're, you know, as you're approaching menopause, you're going to start to see these are two different studies measuring salivary or free testosterone. And there you can see that the level goes down. And then this is two different kinds of, there's three different kinds of estrogen in the body, and these are two of them measured as women get older. This is around the time of menopause. You can start seeing how it just goes down significantly, and when a woman hits menopause, it still keeps going down after that. So it's not like it suddenly cuts off. It's usually a gradual decline over time. So you see that both of them go down. The reason the free testosterone is interesting is because this is, the way that testosterone functions in the body, and same with estrogen, is they're actually bound up by a protein. And if you have higher levels of that protein is going to bind up more of that hormone. So you may get a level that says, hey, I've got a normal testosterone level, but that testosterone, some of it is bound to this protein. So we always check a free testosterone, because that says how much is actually circulating that's in the system and free to help stimulate all those tissues. So when we talk about basic treatments related to hormone therapy, as I said, estrogen is probably the most important hormone when we're talking about a sexual desire. And then there's some controversy about how testosterone is linked. We know that when it comes to older women, the best data that we have, and I'll talk about a lot of the data on treatments at the end, but the best data that we have is honestly that hormones probably are the number one way to help improve desire, and that some combination of estrogen and testosterone, and we always add progesterone to protect the uterus. I'm not sure if you guys have had a talk on menopausal management of symptoms, but I could have an entire lecture on just hormones. I didn't want to make that what this lecture is. But there's really great safety data showing that if you start hormone therapy close to menopause, that you're actually going to see the big concerns that people have in terms of stroke, breast cancer. Those are very, very low risk if you start hormone therapy close to menopause. And actually, if you give people estrogen around the time of menopause, they have even decreased rates of stroke and breast cancer. So a lot of the concern that people have around hormones, it's based on data that was giving women hormones when they were far out of menopause, so at least 10 years out of menopause. When we talk about testosterone, I'm going to get into this later as well, but testosterone is not FDA approved. There are several studies that have shown that it is effective when it comes to treating desire, but it is not an FDA approved treatment. So let's just go back to, we talked about the hormones, we talked about the hormone level on this patient, but let's talk about just the fact that she's 51 and that she has a decrease in desire. Why is this relevant? Well, this is the data. This is a great study that was done by Jan Schifrin, who was actually did training at UCSF, and she looked at basically all different aspects of sexuality and age. And so what she found was that the filled circles is going to be desire problems. These little triangles are going to be arousal problems. And then the squares are orgasmic problems. And so then these open diamonds are gonna be any problem. So this is someone who's reporting any problem with sex or that's causing them distress. And what you can see is based on age, where does it peak? It peaks in the early 50s, okay? So we know epidemiologically, I already said this, that the highest levels of sexual distress are gonna be as women age, but it's not as they get older and older and older. It actually peaks around the time of menopause. And that's partly because of all the things that we just talked about. When I gave you this case, this woman has been married for 25 years, her kids just left, she's probably going through menopause. It's not just menopause, there's a lot of life events that happen around this time. And so we know epidemiologically that this is where we're gonna see the highest levels of distress. But at the end of the day, physical and emotional health is the number one predictor in terms of sexual health. So what does this mean? So when we talk about kind of what other symptoms people are having, it's not just the stereotypical ones that we think about in terms of menopause. So this is a graph that shows women and the prevalence of different symptoms. Postmenopause is purple, this green is gonna be menopausal, and then the light green is gonna be premenopausal. And so the ones that I wanna just really stress are sleep disturbance, vaginal dryness, and vasomotor symptoms. So the one that we oftentimes think about with sex is we always say, oh, vaginal dryness, that must be what it is. But you can see here that sleep disturbance goes up significantly in the postmenopause. Vasomotor symptoms, so that's when we're talking about the hot flashes, those goes up significantly in the postmenopause. We also see that there's higher rates overall of mood symptoms and urinary complaints, but it's not as significant. So it's not just about the vaginal dryness. It's about everything else that's going on in a woman's life that obviously is going to affect her desire to be intimate with her partner. So the next case, this is an older woman. So she's 65, she's complaining of decreased orgasms. She used to be able to orgasm from intercourse with her partner, but in the last few years, it feels like it takes longer and longer. She's tried to use a device on her own, but still finds it's taking too long. Her medical history is notable for high blood pressure and a recent diagnosis of depression after her mother passed away. She's now taking fluoxetine, that's also known as Prozac. Her partner is very loving. She reports their relationship is solid, and he is in the office with her to show support. So I see this all of the time. I see women who got through their menopausal years. They went through the menopausal transition, and their sex life wasn't affected. They're very happy. They had great sex all through menopause, and then suddenly they hit their 60s, they hit their 70s, and something changed. And they're like, what happened? Why is this happening now? And they come in to see me. And I also see the partners all the time, and it makes me really happy when the partners come in to show support. Because again, there's also this oftentimes a stereotype, oh, it's a relationship issue. That's oftentimes not what it is. It can be, but it's not always the case. So what could be going on with this woman? So what do we know about orgasm? So we know that orgasm is a transient peak of basically intense pleasure, and it includes a rhythmic contraction of the pelvic floor muscles. I know last week you had a wonderful lecture on pelvic floor physiology, and so we know how important the pelvic floor is, how often we overlook it when it comes to basically every, you know, most physical concerns, especially gynecologic concerns. But the reason that I think this is important is that orgasm is located in the pelvic floor. A lot of times people think it's in the uterus or in the cervix, but it's not. It's in the pelvic floor and connecting to the brain. So what it's doing is it's basically releasing endogenous opioids, serotonin, prolactin, and oxytocin. So all these yummy hormones that we always hear about, chemicals that we always hear about, neurotransmitters in the brain that are associated with pleasure and bonding. So there's a direct connection between the pelvic floor and the brain. And it basically is subjectively similar between men and women. And there's this idea about a clitoral versus vaginal orgasm, and I think that people have orgasms in different ways. The majority of women orgasm from clitoral stimulation. I saw a patient about a month ago who was, you know, she's been being told by her partner constantly that there's something wrong with her because she doesn't have vaginal orgasms. And I was the first doctor who told her, she's in her mid-30s, that most women don't orgasm from vaginal stimulation. And she was just blown away, and she just told me today she broke up with that person. And she's gonna go, she's like, I wanna thank you, I broke up with him, I finally realized that there wasn't anything wrong with me. And I was like, okay, I, you know, don't know what else is going on in their relationship, but it was amazing that it took her that long to know that, right? So there have been studies, we'll talk a little bit about Masters and Johnson, that really looked at this idea of vaginal versus clitoral orgasm, and there really isn't a difference. The key thing is that the clitoris actually has tissue that extends around the vagina. So there are some people who vaginal stimulation is probably actually just stimulating those clitoral tissues, and they're having orgasms from that. All right, so what can affect orgasm? And these are things that also can affect desire, so this can go back to our first patient. But I think it's always important that, again, we always talk about, oh, it's the relationship, or maybe it's you know, something physiologic, like her vaginal dryness, which it could be. But I also want to know, is she on any medication? So SSRIs are the biggest culprit. So that's our, you know, the fluoxetine, that's your sertraline, so that's your Prozac, that's your Zoloft. Those drugs definitely affect orgasm as well as desire. A lot of antipsychotics do as well. And again, these are all kind of acting on similar pathways. Opiates can, hormonal contraception can. Obviously, in older women, we're not as worried about this, but there definitely is an effect of hormonal contraception. And then chemotherapy certainly can affect orgasm and desire. Medical conditions, diabetes, multiple sclerosis, nerve injuries, chronic pain, genital syndrome of menopause, that's the new term for vulvovaginal atrophy. So most of us are familiar with, you know, vaginal atrophy, but we do now, we're calling it genital syndrome of menopause. That's the new way that we'd like to classify it. And then genital dermatoses. So these are skin conditions that affect the vulva, and those can absolutely affect orgasm. And the reason I think this is important is these conditions here are all nerve related. So clearly, if you have a decrease in nerve sensation, you would expect that it's not surprising that you would have a decrease in orgasm. So non-medical things that can affect orgasm: depression, anxiety, lack of stimulation, and relationship difficulty. So I'm not going to forget that sex isn't just about physical changes. There's a lot of other things that can affect it as well. So it's always important to go through and figure out what could be affecting this woman. So in her case, I'm actually going to be most suspicious about her fluoxetine, because this is someone who was orgasmic for a long time beforehand, and we definitely know that the SSRIs are doing it, but I think it's really important to think about her other risk factors, especially age. There is a change in genital sensation as women get older, and this is kind of a schematic. Again, I didn't put up big diagrams of the vulva and the vagina, but this is an example of what happens as women age. This is their vulvar, basically, this is kind of healthy, mainly vaginal tissue, where you just see multiple layers here of kind of healthy. These are parabasal cells. This is skin cells. And then there's this nice kind of protective layer on top of it. And what happens is all these cell types are still here, but they just get much thinner. Okay, so there's a big decrease in these nice protective epithelial protective cells on top of the skin. And then you're gonna see basically that the skin gets thinner, the acidity of the vagina decreases, and so people are gonna be more prone to getting infections, as well as more prone to tears, as well as more prone to pain. And so this can also affect orgasm as well. So always important to do both a medical history as well as a physical exam. If I were to consider changing her medication, I would certainly talk to her psychiatrist. I would never change anyone's antidepressant medication or any medication that's prescribed by somebody else without talking to them first. But there are some other antidepressants that have less sexual side effects. One of those is bupropion, and this is well known to a lot of psychiatrists as well as gynecologists. It does have other side effects that are different than fluoxetine. So I would always talk to a psychiatrist before, but this is a decent option. Off-label use of sildenafil, we'll talk about this. That's also known as Viagra. But the reason I bring this up is there actually was a randomized control trial published in JAMA, so a very well-respected journal, that did show that sildenafil can help improve orgasmic dysfunction that's related to SSRIs. If I found GSM, so again, that's the vulvovaginal atrophy, that's the thinning of the tissue, I can consider lots of different things, including moisturizers and lubricants. And then we'll talk a little bit about the other medical management of that as well, that's more hormonally based. So I want to just take a step back. So we talked about kind of those two patients. We talked a little bit about the endocrinology of sexual function. We talked about some of the physiology of it. I talked about different medical things that are affecting it. But when we talk about sexual function in general, I think it's really important to think about what is dysfunction and how do we think about just sex in general. So these are the models of sexual function I want us to just take a look at are the, we're gonna start with the male model because it's kind of the simplest. I don't know, has anyone here seen Masters and Johnson, the Masters of Sex? I'm getting some nods. So this is just how I can relate to pop culture. So there's a Showtime series now called Masters of Sex, and it was actually done on Masters and Johnson. So Will Masters was a OBGYN who worked at Washington University in St. Louis in the 50s and 60s. He was the head of their department, very well-established person. And his assistant was named Virginia Johnson. And somehow, Dr. Masters got really interested in studying sex, and he did all of the earliest studies on sexual function, and they studied many, many, many people, men and women, to try to get a sense of what the sexual response is. And they came up with this model, and this is still the most well-established model that we have, okay? And it's from, you know, the 1960s. And it basically describes for men, I bring this up because we're familiar with this, right? So the excitement phase, a plateau phase, orgasm phase, and then a refractory period, and then maybe another orgasm, and then resolution. So it goes down. So they found that for men. So then they said, well, what about women? And what they found was that women were all over the place. And they came up with three different models for women. And the models that they found were, we'll start with A, very similar, an excitement phase, a plateau phase, orgasm, maybe another orgasm, and then resolution. Then they found that there were some that got excited, and then they just plateaued. They never reached orgasm. They kind of just hung out in the plateau, and then they came down. And then they found that there were other women who shot up real fast with excitement and had an orgasm, and then came right down. And there's probably, we could add on many, many lines to this. But I think the reason that I bring this up is women are really variable. And so when we talk about the sexual response, they didn't find there was one way that women responded. They found many, many different ways, but that there probably is in some way an excitement and a plateau phase. Now people criticize this. This was done in the 60s. People get really upset. They don't want to, you know, they don't feel like women are really the same as men. So Rosemary Basson, who's in Canada, a very well-known researcher in Canada, came up with a different model. And her model is circular. And so she says that there are basically, there's a circular response, so that there's incentives for sex that lead to receptiveness, that then maybe get involved with stimuli, then there's arousal, then there's responsive desire, and then there's rewards. And it kind of circles like that. So there is this idea that sex is kind of involves basically a lot more outside factors than just desire, excitement, orgasm, so that women are basically doing it for a lot of different reasons. And the biggest criticism of this is, where does innate sexual desire fit into this? Because I think there's a stereotype that women don't have innate sexual desire, and I think that there's plenty of people that don't have innate sexual desire. We definitely know that that happens for men and for women, but I would argue that the majority of women do have innate sexual desire. And if we don't, if they're not expressing sexual desire, there's oftentimes it's because there's many, many more social components that play a role in women expressing that sexual desire that have developed for years and years and years over her life. So what's interesting about this model is that when they actually studied this, in women, when they said, do they have the female circular model or do they have the Masters and Johnson's model, they actually found that many women will identify with either one or the other. And the ones that identify with the circular model are actually ones that are more likely to also have sexual dysfunction. So definitely women are identifying with both, but oftentimes the circular model, people identify it with it when they're also endorsing other problems with sex. So how does the DSM-4 categorize sexual dysfunction? So this is me giving you guys my little mini medical school talk. This is what I talk to the students and residents and faculty about. So the DSM-4 is the original Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. Remember, when we talk about sexual dysfunction, it usually is contained within the psychiatric world. And the way that the DSM-4, that was kind of the mainstay until about a year ago of diagnoses, they said that there were desire disorders. Those were hypoactive sexual desire disorder and sexual aversion disorder. They also said that there were sexual arousal disorders, and those can be related to genital arousal disorders, subjective arousal disorder, or mixed. There's anorgasmia, or decreased orgasms, and then there's sexual pain disorders. And those pain disorders include pain with sex, so that's what dyspareunia is. Vaginismus is when we talk about tightening, constriction at the level of the vagina. That can be related to both having sex, but it also can be related to many things besides sex. And then non-coital sexual pain disorder. So this is people who aren't actually having intercourse, but they're still having some sort of sexual pain. So the DSM-5 is the new manual that is being used, and they basically updated this, and there's a lot of controversy about this. So basically, to diagnose a woman, she's supposed to have 6 months of symptoms. They basically combined hypoactive sexual desire disorder, sex aversion, and arousal, and they put it all in the same category. So now women are categorized as having sexual desire and arousal disorders. They combined vaginismus and dyspareunia to genitopelvic pain and penetration disorder. And then they also still included the orgasmic disorder. So this is when if the psychiatrist is evaluating somebody, if I'm evaluating somebody and I'm supposed to give them a diagnosis, this is the diagnosis this is how I'm supposed to diagnose them, basically. So these are how we think about the arousal and desire disorder. So absent or reduced interest in activity, thoughts, initiation, excitement, pleasure, response, and sensations. I think that the reason I bring this up is there's a lot of different ways in which people can have desire disorders, and sex isn't just, you know, it's not just do you have desire, there's a lot of different aspects of how desire fits into someone's sexual life. When we talk about prevalence, how common is it to have a sexual arousal or desire disorder? It's somewhere between about 5 and 13%. I usually say about 10%, and this is based on a couple different studies. The sexual pain disorders are actually a little bit more common. So this is pain associated with sexual stimulation, and this can be from vestibulitis, so that's inflammation of the nerves in the vestibule. This can be from endometriosis, so people have pain when they're having sex because they have implants of the uterine lining inside their pelvis. They can have fibroids, it could be after a surgery, this could be psychosocial, it could be from atrophy or GSM, it can be from inadequate lubrication. So in older women, this is more common. We see this in up to 15% of women, so it's super common. Why are guidelines helpful? So I think that it's really important to know that new definitions take into account that pathogenesis of sexual dysfunction is not precise. So it's not like I can, there's a cutoff where we say you have high blood pressure because your blood pressure is above 140 over 90. When it comes to making a diagnosis about something this complex, it's really important to really recognize all the various ways in which someone can have a sexual dysfunction. And a lot of times people don't like the word sexual dysfunction, and it's hard for me not to use that because this is, again, like the doctor hat in me, like trying to give a classification. But that's how we, that is how we like to describe it, because it clearly, when women are coming to me, it's because they're distressed by it. If someone isn't having sex, doesn't have desire, and isn't distressed about it, that's not really my, I'm not concerned about it for her. It's really those that are concerned about it that want to come see me. We know that there's multiple psychological, interpersonal, and organic contributions. And then we also know that these new guidelines talk about that there's overlapping or comorbidity, so that there's various, people can have desire plus an arousal problem. Some people, and I think this is also very important, a lot of women I see have low desire, and then you say, oh, you have low desire, that's the issue, can't help you, there's nothing for your desire. But then if you delve a little further, they say, well, actually I have pain. I've had pain for a lot of years. And maybe the reason they don't desire to have sex is because it hurts to have sex. And nobody ever really talked about that. And so I think it's always important to really, for me, I have to look at the whole picture of what could be causing this. So I ask, you know, several questions related to what's actually going on in her sex life. So when we talk about relationships, I think that that's also a huge key. It's not just about the physical changes. So we know that motivation for sex is different in women who are in new versus long-term relationships. So people, the longer you're in a relationship, the less likely you are to have spontaneous sexual thoughts. And this is not bad, this is just how it is. We know that sexual fantasies help focus sexual feelings and avoid distractions. So it's always, I always try to encourage women, it's okay to fantasize, you're allowed to. And that I think that as we talked about, you know, reasons for motivating sexual interaction as people get older and are in relationships, it might not just be about sex. It's about emotional closeness, appreciation, confirmations of one's desirability. I do think that there is this... that there is a large component of sex that is responsive, I think, for both men and women. So showing desire for a woman is actually gonna get her to be more interested as well. The one thing I also add about this is, you know, whenever I'm seeing somebody that's having sexual complaints, I always ask about the partner. What's going on with your partner? A lot of my patients have partners. They're like, oh yeah, my partner recently was diagnosed with early stage prostate cancer and maybe had surgery or maybe is on medication and maybe their partner actually isn't as interested in sex either. And so there's a huge other component there that's really important to talk about whenever I'm managing this at all and whenever anyone's coming to seek care. So this is how I always like to tell people how to, you know, address sexual health. This is how both providers and I think patients should talk about it. So it's basically using questions related to change in health over the last year as an opportunity. So has anything changed over the last year? Were you diagnosed with any illnesses? How's your relationship going? How's sex been? I always talk about being as specific as possible about symptoms. So this is a way, if your provider's not as comfortable with it, asking, it's always, you know, important to think about how's desire, what's the lubrication like, are you having pain, what's the partner status like. As I said, there's so many different components of sexuality, so it's really important to get into each of them. And then when did they start, and are there any associated factors? I talked to you about my two cases tonight. So I said, you know, someone started a medication, someone's kids just left the house. Oftentimes, you know, something's going on in terms of the partner being sick or something going on kind of emotionally or financially in their life that's really going to be affecting their sexual desire. And then it's always really important to talk about any treatments that people have already tried. So a lot of times people will have been given maybe some sort of hormone replacement therapy or they went to partner therapy. And it's always good to get a sense of what those actually are, what's actually been done, what's worked, what hasn't worked. And it's always important to do a full physical exam, especially if there's any pain. And if, you know, if providers aren't comfortable, if they say, oh, just get over it, this is what happens, you can always ask for a referral. And I think that part of my, you know, role and what I've been doing a lot, you know, in the U.S. is doing a lot of education around sexual health and working with organizations to make providers feel more comfortable addressing these concerns. So we always treat underlying disorders, we always address the relationship and psychosocial issues, we always recalibrate expectations so that if someone comes to me and says, I got married 10 years ago, we were having sex every single day and it was great, and now we're really not, to say, well, that's actually probably kind of normal. Most people really do have less sex as they get older, but what kind of sex would you like to be having? How can we work to get you back to something that works for both of you? I'm going to talk a little bit about kind of sexual enhancement treatments, gels and devices, and then a little bit about pharmacotherapy. This is just getting back again into both my empowerment to the community, but also as my little mini med school lectures that I give to the residents as well. So there's always a role of ancillary providers. So sex therapists are great. They have a variety of training and backgrounds. It's really important to know who you're going to, what their training is, what they're comfortable with. Just because they say, oh, I'm comfortable with sex, with, you know, marriage counseling, that doesn't mean they necessarily are comfortable talking about the nitty-gritty aspects of sexual health. There are sexologists. They actually have PhDs in sexology. Most of them are in the Bay Area. And they have a very multidisciplinary approach to looking at sex. And there are some that are really good out in the community as well. And then there's physical therapists you guys know about. There's life coaches that have their own training. And then there's, you know, group therapy. I don't usually recommend this for sexual dysfunction, but there's a lot of different ways in which people can seek mental health care as well as other physical health concerns. I use physical therapists all the time for my patients that have sexual pain that's related to muscle dysfunction. And I think that one of the things that's really important is anytime that we do an exam to really assess for those muscles. Oftentimes in gynecologic training, we're not taught how to do those pelvic floor muscle examinations. I know Dr. Lager knows how to do it. I do it. A lot of other providers do it, but there are plenty who don't. So there's basically gels. This is mainly lubrication, different types of lubes that I would really encourage people, if they have trouble with lubrication, if they're having pain, to really try to use these. The KY jelly, everyone just knows KY jelly because that's what's at Walgreens. And KY jelly dries up really fast. It's kind of clumpy. There's a huge variety of lube out there that is not KY jelly that's really good. I see a lot of them getting into the Walgreens stores now, or the drug stores. I don't want to say just Walgreens, but a lot of the drug stores. But there are specialty sex stores, especially ones that are more woman-friendly, that have a variety of different types of lubrication. And these can be ones, the water-based lube can have sugar, which is a glycerin, or they can have non-glycerin. There's organic ones that people love. There's ones that are silicone-based. And again, I usually recommend these depending on what someone's symptoms are. If they really are having trouble with lubrication, the silicone-based ones last a lot longer. They can't be used with condoms. But they definitely last a lot longer, and so those can work really well for those types of patients. Some people have a lot of irritation from the glycerin, so I give them the non-glycerin lubes. Some people also use oils. Coconut oil and olive oil are oftentimes given. I think coconut oil is probably safer for the vagina and the vulva than olive oil, but as long as it's washed off afterwards, they're probably okay. Vibrators. So again, there's a huge variety of vibrators. I'm not going to show all of them. I'm showing this one device called Fiera that's actually specifically designed for female sexual dysfunction. It is basically a little suction device that goes on the clitoris to stimulate clitoral blood flow prior to sexual activity. So this is out there. There was another device called Eros, which was a little vibrator that was FDA approved, but it's not on the market anymore for some reason. And there's, when people talk about kind of different types of stimulation, there's ones that stimulate the clitoris and the vagina. There's ones that can be used during intercourse. For my patients who are having a lot of trouble with sensation, that they just feel like they need more clitoral stimulation, something's changed in their orgasms, I actually will educate them about different vibrators that can be used at the time of, if they're used to being able to orgasm from intercourse with clitoral stimulation. There are ones that you can use at the same time, as long as this is where getting the partners involved is really important. That you can also do it without, having intercourse if a partner wants to be involved, and so people can make this a really intimate experience. And those are, there's a lot of different accessories. Again, women positive specialty sex stores are great for this. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about drugs. The first one I'm going to talk about is sildenafil, so that's the Viagra. The key thing is that that the evidence for sildenafil is really equivocal in women with arousal and hypoactive desire disorder. So most of the studies that are done on sexual dysfunction really are focused on desire, because that's actually what most women are coming in for when it comes to sexual health. We definitely see women who come in with sexual pain, and that's actually a little bit easier to treat in some ways because we often can find a physiologic cause of the pain. But the big kind of question now is, what do we do for women who are coming in for low desire? So we know that in general, sildenafil is not good for them. We know that it probably, there's a role for FSD associated with SSRI use. We already talked about that. There was a randomized controlled trial in women that were using SSRIs, and it did help them. They also think that for vascular causes, as well as some of the neurologic causes, again, what sildenafil does is it increases blood flow. We know that it increases blood flow to the male penis, so it actually increases blood flow to the female genital organs as well. So they actually respond very similarly. The structures are very analogous, and so we do see an increase in blood flow. But it's not a decrease in blood flow that's causing low desire for most women. So that's why this isn't going to necessarily work for the majority of women. We know that there's a lot of side effects. I rarely ever prescribe this, and if I do, it's absolutely, you know, it's off-label. It's not FDA approved. It can't be taken with nitrates. We know that there's actually been a lot of studies on women. There were no significant adverse events, at least especially the ones that they saw in men, the really significant ones. But again, the only time I would ever really consider prescribing this is if it's orgasmic or desire dysfunction or problems associated with SSRI use, because there really is good data for that. Flibanserin is a big one that you guys probably have heard about. Have you heard of Addy, the female Viagra? No one's heard about this. This is so interesting, right? So the company's actually not allowed to market this. Flibanserin is the only FDA-approved treatment for hypoactive sexual desire disorder in any gender, in men and women. Okay, so there's no treatment for men who have low desire. They can get Viagra, but that's not for desire. That's for erectile dysfunction. Flibanserin is a drug that's specifically designed for hypoactive sexual desire disorder. I'm giving you all these fancy terms of FHT1A and FHT2A. Basically, what this means is that this is a serotonin. It has mixed serotonin effect. These are serotonin receptors. And basically, flibanserin is a drug that stimulates one serotonin receptor and blocks another one. And as we talked about, we know for a fact that the SSRIs, the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, so those are the antidepressants, those lead to sexual dysfunction, and they lead to orgasmic dysfunction, and they lead to low desire. So we know that. We know that serotonin plays a big role in desire. So the way that they basically kind of discovered which ones, you know, they figured out which receptors do what, they kind of found an opposite effect of one receptor versus another. But essentially, flibanserin affects serotonin. It also affects dopamine. And we don't know exactly how, but we know because all of these neurotransmitters affect desire, that for whatever reason, flibanserin does help affect desire. And what's really interesting about it is that it was actually developed as an antidepressant. So it was developed in the 1990s as an antidepressant, because that's clearly what it is. And it failed as an antidepressant. But it actually, the women who were taking it had significant increases in their level of desire. And if you know that Viagra was discovered as a blood pressure medication. So it was a blood pressure medication that caused vasodilation. And the people in the sexual health community said, you're never gonna find a drug that doesn't cause severe hypotension while at the same time causing an erection. And then sildenafil was found as the only drug that really did that by accident. Flibanserin was similar. It was found as an antidepressant, but it didn't work as an antidepressant, just like Viagra didn't work as a blood pressure medication. But all the men that were taking Viagra wanted to keep taking it, and they couldn't figure out why. And the women who were taking flibanserin, a lot of them wanted to keep taking it because they said it was making them have more sexual desire. So that was how it was discovered. Over many years, it has been studied and studied and studied. And it's been studied mainly in premenopausal women, because that was who they first were really testing it on with depression. And they found that they did have increased rates of desire compared to those that were taking placebo. There was one study that was done, a randomized controlled trial in postmenopausal women of several hundred women, and it did show that those women had an increase in desire. The issue with flibanserin is that the way that they measure outcomes when it comes to sexual dysfunction is they measure the number of satisfying sexual events. So they say over the course of this month or this week, how many sexual events did you have that were satisfying? That could be intercourse, that could be making out, that could be masturbation, but is it satisfying? And then they also study desire. The satisfying sexual events is how they studied Viagra, and that's kind of how everyone's doing things. And there's a little bit of a problem with that because most women are really coming in complaining of desire problems. But regardless of how the outcomes are studied, what I think is really important is that the FDA did approve flibanserin because they found that over most of the studies that over the course of a month, women had about 1 to 1.5 more satisfying sexual events a month. That's what most of the published studies show. And I'm not gonna get into, I think I put this talk together before the JAMA article was published like 2 weeks ago, where there was a JAMA article that showed that with unpublished data that they think the effect of flibanserin might not be as strong. So there's a lot of controversy right now about how effective flibanserin is. At the end of the day, what I want you guys to take home is that this is the only FDA-approved treatment for female sexual dysfunction. Right now, it's only FDA-approved for premenopausal women. And there is concern about side effects due to low blood pressure with this medication. So you're not supposed to drink alcohol when taking the medication. And so that's the advice that we give. So REMS is interesting. So REMS is an FDA approved, it's basically an FDA policy that is, it's risk evasion or mitigation strategy. So basically, the doctors that can prescribe flibanserin, they have to be registered to prescribe it. Yes, you can. We wonder about this too. So the only other drug actually that's commonly used by OBGYNs that requires a REMS is mifepristone, which is what's used for first trimester medical abortion. So that you have to get registered to prescribe, understandably. And flibanserin, you have to be registered to prescribe. Opiates, benzodiazepines, all the other drugs that we prescribe very commonly, we don't need REMS to approve. Basically, the FDA, there's a lot of politics involved in how this drug got approved, but the FDA basically said that, okay, we'll approve it. We have enough data to show that it's probably effective, but we're concerned about these side effects. We want to make it really hard for people to get. So we have a REMS. I can answer more questions about this later, but basically the only people that can prescribe flibanserin have to be registered to prescribe it. Hormones, just in the last few minutes. So we already talked about estrogens and we talked about estrogen. So we know that topical estrogen is really good for vaginal dryness and genital syndrome of menopause. We can use creams, we can use a vaginal ring, we can use a vaginal tablet. These are super safe. We give these to women that have had hormone receptor positive breast cancer. A lot of the concerns about hormones I'm happy to address in questions, but I just want to put it out there that overall hormones are very, very safe. We have to be careful about how we prescribe them, but most doctors are, and I do think that they can be really beneficial. If you have a family history of cancer, if you even have there's lots of different reasons that people are concerned about hormones, but overall they're actually very safe and they can really improve quality of life. Selective estrogen receptor, this is FSD, so this is osbemafine is the only FDA approved treatment for female sexual dysfunction due to vaginal dryness. So flibanserin is for desire, and then osbemafine is a pill that is targeting the vaginal tissue. So you can take it, and it causes increase in estrogen at the level of the vagina and the vulva to improve dryness. So for people who can't do these topical treatments, osbemafine is a good option. Tibolone has multiple different, it's not approved in the US, but it's also a medication that has different hormonal effects. Testosterone, I'm just going to close with this. A lot of people get testosterone as they age. So I don't say as they age, but older women who have sexual dysfunction, they're coming in oftentimes asking me to test all of their hormone levels, and they want to have their testosterone, their estrogen, their progesterone. Everything has to be in some level that they're being told is the right level. There is no evidence for any of that. So what we know about testosterone is that there's no single level that's predictive of sexual response. That means if I tested your testosterone and if your free testosterone was 2.3, I could test the person next to you and their testosterone is 2.3 and you guys are gonna have totally different levels of desire. There's no one level that's indicative. But we do know that there is probably a role that as women's testosterone decreases, that individual woman may have a change in her desire. So we know that if we give women testosterone, and there's a lot of studies on this, that we see a significant increase in that woman's desire. And the effect of testosterone is definitely more than the effect of flibanserin. But the reason that testosterone is never going to be approved is because we're really concerned about the side effects. And the main ones are going to be breast and uterine cancer. We don't have good data for this. And we do know that there are other side effects, including hirsutism. So that's, facial hair, acne. There's change in cholesterol levels. But the data is equivocal for whether or not that really does affect cardiovascular disease. What we know about testosterone is that it causes those side effects. For the cardiovascular data, we know that transsexuals who were actually given really, really high levels of testosterone actually didn't have increased rates of cardiovascular disease, so there is a question there. In the breast cancer data, we have a really small number of women in the nurses' health study, so that was a huge study, and it showed that there were a small number, less than 50 women who were taking estrogen plus testosterone, and their risk of breast cancer was very similar to the risk of those who were taking estrogen plus progesterone. So there was a little bit of an increased risk, but it was the same in those who take estrogen plus progesterone. So it's not hugely high, but we don't have any real long-term data. One of the other studies in the Women's Health Initiative didn't find any increased risk of breast cancer in women who were taking estrogen and testosterone compared to those who weren't. So I think that for these two, question is still out there. There was one drug that they did have safety data for, but interestingly, that one drug. It didn't get far enough along in the trials in order to really know what that data showed. So I think the bottom line on testosterone is that the data is insufficient to demonstrate significant adverse effects. We know that off-label use, this is very commonly used when I give lectures to OBGYNs in the community and I ask who's prescribing it. I get really high numbers of people prescribing it, which I find really interesting. NAMS is the North American Menopause Society. This is a group of mainly OBGYNs and internists. These are kind of the big, huge experts in hormones. If you want to know anything about hormones, go to their website. And basically, they said that postmenopausal women with decreased desire may be candidates. They do recommend using it with estrogen. ACOG is the American College of OBGYNs. That's the kind of governing body for me and Dr. Lager. And they actually put out in their sexual health guidelines that transdermal testosterone is effective for hypoactive sexual desire disorder. And they actually gave it a level A evidence grading, which is really high for what we see. So I think that, the thing about testosterone is it's not FDA approved. Anytime someone comes to me for testosterone, we need to have a long conversation about it. I monitor the levels of testosterone over time. Because we don't have an FDA approved medication for women, it becomes a little bit tricky to how to administer it, so we usually have to compound it. So there's more, it's really important to think about how we're giving it, but there's a lot of people out there that are using it. So there's some developing and alternative therapies. Zestra is this kind of hormone. There's a little bit of, it's like an herbal supplement for women that's been studied, same with L-arginine. Bremelanotide is one that's, it's a medication I'm not going to get into the nitty-gritty details of it, but basically it's a melanocortin that probably is the most promising at this point as an on-demand drug for desire. So remember, everything I talked to you about thus far has been kind of long-term treatments, right? Flibanserin is a daily pill, testosterone you put on once or every other day. These are things like, so I'm in the mood, I want something like Viagra, can I take something to help get me in the mood more? So bremelanotide is being developed for that. So is Libridos. This is a combination of several of the medications we talked about, including testosterone and then buspirone, which is related to bupropion as well, and sildenafil. And then there's a lot of compounded combinations. There's a lot of compounding pharmacies out there selling all of their stuff or, trying to get you to use all of it. I'm very wary of compounded medications. One caveat to this is that I can't get testosterone in a dose for women that's not compounded. But in general, compounding pharmacies, a lot of people come in on their compounded estrogen and progesterone. compounding pharmacies have been studied that even in the same pharmacy, week to week, the dosage is different in the products that they're producing. And oftentimes the products they're producing they're not absorbed by the body the same way that the FDA-approved treatments are. So something like testosterone that I'm in a little bit of a bind with, I can't get it non-compounded. Anything, you know, I'll do if I have a trusted pharmacy, but compounded estrogen and progesterone, I'm very wary of. I don't recommend it. I think that there's a lot out there where people think that's the only option and that's the safest and healthiest option. I'm happy to answer more questions why. But if you can get something that's FDA approved, I certainly recommend doing that. So I think we know that sexual health is very important to women. We know that sexual health changes over time. We know that there are multiple factors that affect women's sex life as they age. This could be, you know, a date. Actually, I do teach a two-day course with a lot of other people about sexual health. So in 1 hour, I know there's a lot to cover. We know that there's a broad range of causes, and that when we're talking about treatments, there need to be physiologic and psychosocial. We talk about in the sexual health community the biopsychosocial model of sexual health. There's a biological part, there's a psychological part, and there is a social part. And it's always important, I think, in any condition, but especially related to sex, which is my, you know, obviously the one I'm most interested in. There are a few FDA-approved therapies, and this is going to change. There's a lot of interest in this. I think there's a lot of politics and controversy about flibanserin, and it's creating a really big stir in a lot of the development of other drugs and treatments for sexual dysfunction on the medical side. So I think we're going to kind of see this field is in a really huge transition, especially because now we actually have two FDA-approved drugs, acetaminophen as well as flibanserin, that are actually even related to the indication sexual health. And there are many treatments, you know, even if they're not FDA approved, there's still many treatments. And I just scratched the surface of what those are. But I think we're going to see more and more over time. And I think more and more people are going to be asking and wanting them as well. Part of what I think is really important about these new treatments is that it's actually just getting sexual health out of the shadows. Just like Viagra did that for men could actually talk about this really distressing part of their life. I think it's really important that women now are going to be able to start talking about it as well. So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions. The question is whether or not because we know that the ovaries produce testosterone, do the testicles produce estrogen? I think they do. I'm not a urologist, but yes, I'm pretty sure they do. They're analogous structures and they produce hormones, so yeah.
And so is there a role in estrogen in male sexuality?
Oh, that is a great question. If you gave a male estrogen, which they do in women who are transitioning, whether or not that affects their sexual function is actually really tricky. So when you give men estrogen, they're going to get like female characteristics, right? So they get breast development, some of them will lactate, their composition of their body fat changes, and the question's going to be whether or not, most likely it's not going to affect their sexual health, because and this is a conjecture, I would have to ask somebody, but physiologically, if you're giving someone exogenous, so estrogen in the form of a pill, you're going to increase their sex hormone binding globulin, and that's going to bind up all their free testosterone. So I actually think it's the opposite of what you're suggesting, because we know that that's what happens if you give women extra hormones. That's why birth control pills, for example, are associated with decreased desire, is because you're basically giving them hormones, you're increasing their hormone binding globulin, and so they have this protein that's going around and binding up all their free testosterone and probably some of their free estrogen as well. Does that answer your question? Yeah. Uh-huh, question there. That's a great question. So the question is whether or not insurance covers the treatments. So the treatments that insurance does cover are going to be hormone replacement therapy. I've never had insurance not cover a form of hormone replacement therapy. Whether or not it's the one I prescribe and I prefer to use is the bigger question, because there are so many different forms out there. And when I talk about hormone replacement, we're now kind of saying hormone therapy. That's estrogen and progesterone. For women, those are very commonly used to treat a variety of symptoms. So when women are transitioning in the perimenopausal to menopause, I've never had someone not be able to get it. It's what kind I give them that is always a question. So that's the main one. The other treatments that I think you're thinking of would be something like testosterone will not get approved. That is true. And I think that there's ways in which to think about financially how much it costs. So in general, the compounded creams that people get are about $50 to $100 a month. Some people do use off-label the male formulations, but it's a little bit nuanced because the male level of testosterone is 10 times the female level, so you need to use 1/10 of the dose in a woman. And if you do that, the formulations for men will last for about a year if you give them a bottle of that. So it actually averages out the same kind of price-wise. This is, again, why we have all this data on testosterone. It would be great if it could be FDA approved, but I understand, again, why there's a lot of safety concerns and why people are really, you know, cautious about it. Flibanserin is... and in theory approved because it's literally the only treatment option there is for female sexual for hypoactive sexual desire, but it is extraordinarily hard to get any insurance to cover it. So any public insurance isn't going to cover it, and then a lot of the private insurers are making people jump through a lot of hoops to get it. So I think it's a great question, and I wish it were different. It's similar on the male side, actually. Sildenafil isn't approved for a lot of people, and it's priced pretty high as well. But most private insurance will cover sildenafil, but I can't. It's like pulling teeth to get insurance to cover flibanserin for my younger patients, and then for postmenopausal women, I have nothing besides just the traditional estrogen and progesterone that insurance would ever cover. But I think that this is partly, you know, part of, you know, the more that women talk about this being an issue in their lives, the more that the FDA is going to listen and stop saying this isn't a big problem, we're not going to approve a lot of these drugs. I think that there's a give and take now that more and more women are saying this is important to them and they're supporting a lot of the development of various drugs. Uh-huh.
You mentioned a couple of issues around dryness and around the thinning of the vagina and around vulvar atrophy. Is that what you use the creams for, and do those reverse that, or is it just make it feel better?
That's a great question. So the question is whether or not, so when someone has what we call genital syndrome of menopause, so that's thinning of the tissue in the vagina, the vulva, that's associated with getting older, and that's actually directly related to the decrease in hormone level, so estrogen and testosterone mainly, that's causing that. So the question is, if we give treatment, are you just making it feel better, are you actually reversing it? You're reversing it. So when you give somebody topical estrogen directly onto the vagina and the vulva, or for people who take ospemifem, it works a little bit better in the vagina than the vulva. You're actually giving the estrogen back to that tissue, so you're increasing blood flow, you're going to increase moisture, you're going to increase elasticity. So if I ever want to talk to somebody about how can I actually make this better or reverse what's going on, that's how you do it. The creams, like the lubrication and the vaginal moisturizers, that's just making it feel better. That doesn't reverse it. So it's always an educational, you know, question when people are really concerned about hormones to kind of get the sense of, you know, we cannot use hormones, but we're actually not going to make it better. But we can make it feel better, at least for you to have sex. Some people have so much dryness that it hurts to sit down, you know? And so we can definitely help with that symptom-wise, but we're not actually going to reverse the process like you would do with topical estrogens. Mm-hmm. So the question is, for my patients, do I prefer the topical estrogen or the patch? Do you mean like transdermal estrogen for like hot flashes or?
Well, I don't have a patch.
Okay, so yeah, so there's different. Yeah, so the question is that. Sure. So the question is different forms of giving estrogen. So I think it's a little bit tricky to go into the hormones exactly to explain, but there's different ways that we give hormones for different reasons. So if someone is just having vaginal dryness or pain with sex and it's just localized to the vaginal and vulvar tissue, the treatment of choice is topical estrogen. So that would either be a cream, a pill, or a ring to put inside the vagina, or the ospemifem, the oral pill that targets the vaginal tissue. if somebody is having symptoms related to menopause that are systemic, so that's hot flashes, that's mood changes, that's irritability, that is due to a blood level decrease in estrogen that's affecting the brain, that's the kind that I recommend things like the patch, because what the patch is doing is it's depositing the estrogen directly into your bloodstream. There's also pill forms of estrogen that are targeting, again, the blood level of estrogen. And those are given to address systemic symptoms of systemic deficiency in estrogen. So if someone comes to me and their only complaint really is a vulvar or vaginal complaint, I don't give them the patch. I don't give them systemic estrogen. I give them local estrogen. It works better. And it certainly is going to have less side effects too. Yeah. So the question is whether or not the patch could cause a distended belly. I think people have all kinds of weird reactions to hormones. And so I have not seen someone having a distended belly, but I think anytime we give people hormones, they oftentimes will complain of various symptoms. One thing that I see people is it's not when I give them an estrogen patch, but if you have a uterus, we have to also give, so these are for women that, you know, the majority of women haven't had a hysterectomy. So if you give them estrogen, you also have to give them progesterone. And remember, progesterone, I didn't get into it, but progesterone's the hormone that comes on in the second half of the menstrual cycle. It's the hormone that's really high in pregnancy and in breastfeeding. So if you think about that, that's like the bloating hormone and the tired hormone. And so oftentimes it's the progesterone that I give people that gives them a lot of those symptoms. But it could be the estrogen. And if it happens, then I would say I would work with somebody to figure out some sort of medication that works better for them. Maybe a different formulation of estrogen, or if you can't take any estrogen, there are some other non-hormone therapies we use to help some of the symptoms. Nothing works quite as well as hormones, but we certainly have alternatives.
That was, I think you touched upon this. There was a controversy about hormone therapy causing or increasing the chances of cancer.
Uh-huh.
Does that apply to all of these topical treatment?
That's a great question. So the question is whether or not hormones, the controversy with hormones causing cancer, does that relate to the topical treatments? I'm going to address this in two parts. The first part is the issue of hormones causing cancer, and this is a little bit complicated to get into the data, but I'm just going to give a little bit of history. Historically, people gave out hormone therapy when women started menopause, oftentimes regardless if they had any symptoms, because when they looked, basically looked back, they saw that women who were on hormones had less cancer, less heart disease, you know, less bone disease, did better. So everybody was getting hormones. There was never a study that actually randomized women that said, I'm going to give a group of women hormones and then I'm going to give a group of women a sugar pill and let's see what happens. And that's what we call the rants. When we talk about the randomized control trials, those are kind of the pinnacle of evidence where we can say, was it specifically this medication that caused this outcome? That was the Women's Health Initiative. And they randomized women to a specific type of estrogen, an oral pill, and then a specific type of progesterone. And what they found was that the women that they randomized had higher rates of stroke, of breast cancer, and of heart attacks. So that was in 2002 when that came out, and that's when everybody stopped taking hormone therapy. That's when testosterone was up at the FDA when they were trying to get it approved, and there was no way they were ever going to get it approved. So that was number one. What ended up then happening was they looked back and they said, this is really weird. Why do we have all this other data that doesn't suggest this? And what they found was that the average age of the women in those studies was 63 when they started. So they were over 10 years out from menopause. And when they looked at the women who were actually closer to menopause, less than 10 years out, age 50 to 59, they found that those women that got estrogen and progesterone actually did better. They had less cardiovascular disease. They had less stroke. And the breast cancer piece was the one piece that was a little bit tricky. And what they found was that the increased rate of breast cancer was actually due to the progesterone type that they were given. And so it was a specific type of progesterone. So it wasn't the estrogen, it was the progesterone. So the take home from this is that, and this has been shown again and again, and we know for a fact that estrogen therapy helps with bone health and it decreases colon cancer. And it did in all of these studies. So we know that it decreases colon cancer risk. The big question is whether or not it increases breast cancer. And so the bottom line is that if you give women hormone therapy closer to menopause within 10 years, and I'm usually seeing women within 5 years, the data is very, very clear that it is safe and it's probably beneficial. So that's that piece that I think didn't get the same level of press. There have been study after study after study, but it wasn't so scary, so the press hasn't focused on it. But most providers now are giving hormone therapy. But you know, I actually have a family member that went to her doctor for, because she was having dryness. She's older and she was having dryness and she wanted hormone therapy, and they told her she couldn't get it. It's gonna give her cancer. And so she asked me, and I said, you know, here's the data. So this is the second part of your question. How about these topical ones? Because those were oral estrogen. And we're talking about the transdermal, the systemic ones. The ones that you're putting directly on the vagina and the vulva, no risk at all, okay, when it comes to breast cancer, uterine cancer. They've studied this over and over and over again, that they have not shown an increased risk of uterine cancer. When you give these medications, there is a transient increase in the blood level of estrogen. There is a little bit of absorption into the blood. So if you measure estrogen, you are going to see it, but then it goes down to almost none. And these are local treatments. So you don't even need, if we're worried about uterine cancer, I don't even need to give somebody progesterone, which is the reason we give progesterone is to protect the uterus. You don't even have to give it if you're giving these topical estrogens. So that's a very long-winded answer. I talk about this all the time. I'm really interested in the hormone debate because I think all of this is really, when we look at kind of data and what it shows and how it gets misconstrued. So the answer to your question is hormone therapy within 10 years of menopause, not associated with cancer, probably beneficial. Local hormone therapy, local estrogen, not associated with cancer, absolutely safe.
Just to follow on, then, yeah. Within 10 years, does that mean continue taking it beyond the 10 years of menopause or stop?
Great question. So the question is, when you start taking hormone therapy, how long should you take it for? Should you stop it when you hit 60? Is that going to be a problem? Because we know if you start it after 60, you're going to be associated with risks. So right after the WHI, and for the last actually 15 years, people have been really scared about, okay, well, how long should people be on it? We know that people are on it. We know it's probably safe if they started in their 50s. And literally up until this year, there was the kind of guiding principle was that you use the smallest amount possible for the shortest amount possible. But actually ACOG and all of the data and all the societies are now coming out saying that if you're doing well on it, take it for as long as you want. There is no reason to stop it. Because the reason that there is a risk of starting after 60 is because what the estrogen is trying to prevent has already happened, and estrogen's making it worse. So the idea is that if you have an artery, you want the artery to be nice and clear, you know, like blood to flow through. And what happens is that after menopause, it can start to get clogged up. And if you put estrogen on top of that, it makes it worse. But if you give estrogen before, it will actually prevent it from getting clogged to begin with. So it's a little counterintuitive that estrogen is probably benefiting the arteries long term, but if you give it too late, it's going to actually make it worse. So there's no reason to stop at any time if people are doing well on it. Oftentimes my patients want to wean down, so we'll start kind of weaning down and seeing how they're doing. But if their hot flashes come back, if their insomnia, if their irritability comes back, perfectly fine to go back up on it. Question?
So with the topical, is that like forever or is that just for a short period? Like, how do you know, like, is the topical, like, how does that?
That's a great question. So the question is, how long do you use the topical for? As long as you need it. So I usually, you know, most people take it and they oftentimes will need it indefinitely, because the truth is there are certain things that get better in menopause over time. So over time in menopause, hot flashes get better, irritability, mood changes, all of those kind of systemic things. We know that those usually get better over time, but things like vaginal dryness or bone density or cardiovascular risk, those all get worse over time. And so I do think that if someone's taking vaginal estrogen, as long as, you know, if it's working and they stop using it and the dryness starts coming back, they should start using it again. The other thing is that if, you know, it depends on why you're using it. If people are using it because they're having pain with sex, the more sex you have, the better for the vaginal health is going to be. So oftentimes people will start using these treatments and then they're able to have sex. They're able to, you know, I hate to use the word, say the thing, use your vagina more regularly, but they're actually like engaging in more sexual activity, and it actually does keep the tissue elastic and keep it really healthy. So they may be able to decrease the amount of estrogen that they're using over time. The more sexual activity people do, it actually does maintain vaginal health because you're increasing blood flow. The more you're increasing blood flow just by sexual activity. So you're kind of, you know, you're keeping the tissue elastic, you're increasing blood flow, so you oftentimes maybe won't need it as much. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's a good question. So the question is, do I check baseline labs? So there is really no evidence to check baseline labs before starting someone on hormone therapy. And the reason is because if you're coming to me with symptoms of estrogen deprivation, no matter what your level is, you're having symptoms from it being too low. And so I wouldn't say I'm not going to give it to you now. What I do that's different is that if someone's been on, so that's the main question. Same with, actually, it's really just with the estrogen and progesterone. If someone wants testosterone, I always check baseline labs because I need to know where they're starting because I need to follow it. Because testosterone, again, I'm giving them formulations that I cannot say are FDA approved, that I know exactly how much they're getting. I need to follow that to make sure that if they're using a cream, they're not using too much or too little, or it's getting too high, or if they're having side effects, where are they at? So that is very important for me to check. When women have been on hormone therapy for a while and they're still having symptoms, I have a patient who's still, she's really fatigued. And a lot of my patients think that their fatigue is really related to their hormone levels. And I think that as people get older, there's a lot of different things that can cause fatigue, not necessarily a lack of estrogen. And so in cases like that, I do check the levels because I can say, you know, could this possibly be related? And if they're at a level that's really reasonable, then I'm certainly not gonna go up on their estrogen. I don't want them to have high levels. I want them to really be at a, I do know what level I'd like someone to be at, but that's after they're on treatment. Yeah, and if I'm questioning if their symptom is due to it. If you're still having hot flashes, no matter if I've given you some estrogen, you don't have enough estrogen, because I know that that's really connected. Yeah.
So we had a thyroid person. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, like, so how, like, the TSH and all the other, like, thyroid function, how it relates to estrogen and, like, and as you hit menopause and all, like, what are the relationships, especially with bone density and absorption?
That's a good question. So the question is, how does the thyroid and the rest of the endocrine system relate? So I'm not a thyroid expert. I know that there are ideal levels of thyroid function, not, I wouldn't say ideal levels. There are levels that suggest that you have a lower versus a higher level of thyroid hormone in your body. The way that the thyroid hormone really affects estrogen and progesterone levels, and this is really gonna be mainly in premenopausal women, is that the one of the components of the thyroid cascade is tied back to the same gland in the brain that can help stimulate estrogen and testosterone production at the level of the ovary. So one of the reasons that people who have hypo or hyperthyroid disorder may have abnormal menses is because there's a feedback mechanism on that gland in the brain that is sending the signals to the ovaries to release estrogen and testosterone. Does that make sense? So I think that that's really the main kind of component in terms of it's the hypothalamic pituitary axis that's related. They're all kind of made by similar structures, and so they can feed back on each other. So I think that if someone comes to me for fatigue, for example, I always check a thyroid level, because that I'm thinking more of is a thyroid issue as opposed to necessarily a hormone issue or an estrogen or progesterone issue. Does that answer your question? And part of the, I think where it always gets tricky is, right, I'm a gynecologist, so I think in terms of estrogen, progesterone, testosterone. The thyroid person thinks in terms of like thyroid, you know? So it's like we don't get all together, you know, unless you have kids. And they'll be the experts. Who's next? All right, well, thank you very much for coming. I'm always happy to answer more questions afterwards. It's late, so enjoy the rest of your nights.